Hey, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Wifey. Another day in the upper room, and well, thank God for making it happen for us. So we've been sharing on the rich woman at Shunem. That's been our main topic. We've gone away and talked about some other things, but all right, this morning, let's probably get back to where we were sharing earlier on and where we start. We spoke about, the last time we spoke about it, we talked about the continuum of life. We come into this life dependent, right? And that's when we need maximum parenting. But we don't stay dependent. We begin to learn how to do things. And we move from dependent to what we call independent status, right? We max that out when we're in our teens. We're leaving our teens and become young adults. We're fully what we call independent adults, right? And from then on, we don't stop there either, right? There's a place of dependent, independent. There's a place then when we call interdependent, right? That is a place whereby we begin to choose to release some of the hold of our independence. We choose, we realize that we're not complete in our own selves alone. Yes, it's important to love ourselves. Yes, it's important to know ourselves. Yes, it's important to know who we are and want to be all that God has made us to be, the fullness expression of what God has made us to be. But that has to be in an environment where we recognize that we're not alone in this life. And we're not the only ones that have the right to be here. Every other person around us has the same right as we do to this universe, right? So that place of, even though I have my full power, I begin to understand that I need to live with other people. I need to coexist with other people. Yes, I have matured, I'm independent, but that is not the end of my maturity. The height, the zenith of my maturity is in respecting other people as well, not wanting things at the expense of other people, knowing that in my exerting my right, I have no right to hinder the right of another person or oppress the right of another person. It's a live and let live mentality, right? Whereby we understand that we choose sometimes to let go some things, if only to make communal living possible, right? And you can only do this when you have mastery over yourself. If you don't have mastery over yourself, you're lost in independent status. For each of you to move from an independent status to an interdependent status, you have to be someone who has mastered yourself. You have to be someone who owns your spirit, your soul, and your body. Because what you don't own, you cannot give, right? You have to own before you can give it. Right, so you cannot jump from dependent to interdependent. You have to first of all be independent. You have to hone yourself. You have to have your belt of truth that is holding everything in your life together. Because until you can hold everything in your life together, you cannot fully use it. Right, so you have to come to a place of knowing yourself, understanding yourself, understanding who you are, why you are here, and what is it that you're trying to accomplish. Only when you do that, do you have enough mastery then to master others, not master others in terms of oppressing them, but mastering your relationship with them such that their own, so that you're able to have what we call harmony, right? You're able to have serenity. You're able to have a place where you are truly a blessing to other people. You are not a blessing to them because of what you want from them. You are a blessing to them for their own sake, right? Like someone would define healthy relationship. What's an healthy relationship? An healthy relationship is a relationship which two or more people come into for the sake of what they can give, not what they can receive. They go into it because of what they can give, not what they can receive, right? However, what keeps that relationship together is not what they give, it is what they receive. That's called the paradox of relationship. Anyway, my time is up. It's time to pray. Let's pray. La perché di babacchi e di vostri le brocaste di via babacchi a caschi e crede broca carche dei te e delle grida braca basa garaba gabrto di e la braca casi che regge de bossi e delle grene gre de brocchi e delle le broca casi che re le broca ba la braca ba a chi le brocco si de re le baraba la braca crucon delle bossi che de gaga di e de de e grene cala pro cocoti e le greda braba baba caraca no crucin de bossi e le braba Aldi de broca sine cre e le broca bazaga raba de broca baba bashikala to koru e de cre na sotto la barashaya bo pare che debo si cre la braca cre debo e al libro kinde geze cre la braca sikina na 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 ya ya sacha ya da re kishiti e kiti e rinara Poto poto, ore sataya, lari da 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 da, ati di do do. Le broco era la bascia para sia da para para bascia, sai cara va da 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 da, sekiti.
Broca ca. Madre que le gezegre baba tiene bocos
Baba, 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 Pandoro Bobo Baba Shakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Mendara Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Riba Kakata Pakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Riba Kakata Pakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya Raba Baba Makata Pakala Baya Kakata Pakala Baya
Yala
Hey, thank you. Thanks for coming to pray. You know, we'll just continue with our Ritual Manna Chinem series. Continue talking about going from dependent to independent, right? And saying that we don't end at independent. We need to go to interdependent, because that is the way or place whereby we learn how to live and let live, right? A lot of people are lost in being independent. It's good to be independent, right? But it's wrong to stay there, because if you stay there, you will not be able to live in communal thing. That's a problem with marriages today. A lot of people go to marriage and want to be independent. If two people are independent in marriage, that marriage will not work. It's two captains in a boat, two captains in a ship. It's not going to work. Even if one is independent and the other one is not, it's still not going to work, right? Because marriage is giving and receiving. Right, again, I defined it on what we call a paradox of relationship, a paradox of a healthy relationship. Because the healthy relationship is one in which you go into for the purpose of giving, not receiving. People that go into marriage for what they will get have a wrong notion of marriage. Marriage has nothing to do with what you receive. It's about what you will give. It's a decision you make to go to another level of life, a higher level of life, where you'll be a blessing to the person to whom you are entering into a relationship with. You are going there because of what you can give, not what you can receive. If you go there because of what you can receive, you're a failure already. That's a lot of sad in marriages today, because they go there because, oh, to make me happy. Oh, you will pay this, you will do that. The man has no clue what it is that you are looking for. Right, marriage is not because of what you can get, it's about what you can give. And what keeps a relationship together is not what you give, it is what you get. Right, they look opposite, it's called a paradox. Right, what keeps you in relationship with anybody is not what you are giving, it is what you are receiving from that relationship. But you must not go into it because of what you are going to receive, right? What you might think you are giving, you're the one giving, but what only keeps you giving is the satisfaction, right? The fulfillment you are getting, the sense of responsibility, the sense that you are where you ought to be, right? And that's what you call interdependent relationship. So we start from being dependent, we'll grow to being independent, then we'll grow into interdependent. And only when we're interdependent are we ready for marriage. If you're not interdependent, you don't qualify for a marriage, right? Yeah. And that's just a continuum of life. And when we live this life, then we're stable, we're confident, we're able to walk in our stride, we're able to be like example of what we see in the rich man at Shunem. If you see our life, you see that there was nothing broken, nothing missing. Yes, she didn't have a child, but she don't allow that not having a child to stop her, right? Because again, going back to her again, is the fact that we all have a bot in our life, but the bot in our life is not meant to stop us. The bot in our life is just meant to remind us of our humanity, but not to hinder the progress of our life, right? The bot in your life is probably something you cannot do, brought. Life is not about what you cannot do. Life is about all the things you can do. Right? God is not going to hold you to ransom for the things you cannot do. Elisha coming to that city, he was not looking for a child from the woman. But there were things the woman could do. She didn't have a child, yes.
But she was rich. She had an extra room. She had extra food. She could accommodate the prophet. It is because she didn't have a child, it doesn't mean that she should not be hospitable. Because the things you can do are the things that bring about your miracle, not the things you cannot do. It doesn't matter what has been taken away from you. You have enough to fulfill purpose. There's nobody that's useless. There's nobody that's been deprived so much that they don't have what it takes to move to the next level of their life. And you don't need anything they call destiny helper. That is a lie of the devil. I continue to say that, but we'll continue tomorrow. I have to stop here. But we'll talk more about that. For those that are still looking for destiny helper, we need to discuss, because you are not, it's not according to the word of God. But I'll stop there. Yeah. Hey, anybody here that believes in destiny helper? My wife is one of those that believe. We are still working.
Okay.
Who has believed in destiny helper?
Has she gotten some of the helpers? Have they come around?
Yeah. Has not gotten, no. She's not believing God. But anyway, I'm still working on her. We're almost reaching the promised land. Is that okay? Are you looking for destiny helper?
I am looking for destiny helper.
God has already connected us to destiny helpers, because our God is a refuge and a present help in the time of need. So God is our destiny helper. So that is where I'm talking.
It's the human part one that God is our destiny.
Yes.
Your destiny helper is already crying around you. Mike, yeah. Mike, are you one of those looking for destiny helper?
I will say that if God wants to help us, come to a man.
He can use a man, yes. But the focus must always be on God. Where people miss it is when they start focusing on man.
That's it.
When you talk destiny helper, they are focused on man. That is where they miss it. It's called idolatry. Right? God will use man, but God that will choose man, so that glory will always be God, not the man. Problem is that people are looking for destiny helper, and the glory becomes the destiny helper zone, and they are robbing God of his destiny, of his glory. And God will not share his glory with any man. So when I say destiny helper, there's no like destiny helper. I'm not saying God does not use people.
Yeah,
God must never go off God. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
God must always be on God. The glory must always be his. And he can choose to use anybody. He tries to use man A, man A will refuse to do it. You use man B refuse. You use man C, right? For as long as your focus is on God. But if your focus is on man A, you wait for 38 years. Right?
The man A, I've not even heard. He's trying to hear God on other issues.
Abi, poor man, he has no trouble. He has no problem. You are coming to add your own to his problem. Anyway, let you go. We'll continue tomorrow. God bless you.
Okay, man.
Oh, my wife said, what did you do?
I'm waiting in the chat.
Right. My wife says, so read the chat.
We should have a discussion for clarity's sake.
Anyway, we'll have. But the summary is that it's not that God will not use people. God will use people. But your focus must never be a man. Always be on God. Right? That's the key thing. Jesus Christ goes to the man at Bethesda. And he asked the man, do you want to be healed? The man said, I have no man. I want a relationship with the person again. Do you want to be healed? I have no man.
It was depending on man to get him there.
Say that again.
I said it was depending on man to get him in there for healing. And that was not God's way of doing it.
Absolutely. So he had waited for 38 years. I have no man.
And he will never have man, because man is missing.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Anyway, I need to let you go. It's past time.
That's a good one. Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
All right.
Yeah. Bye.
tomorrow.